In this presentation, I will argue that informal practices, which are a constitutive element of the Greek sociopolitical formation, are not a sign of underdevelopment, but rather they are patterns of dynamic adaptation which shape Greece's own path to modernity. In the next 15 minutes, I will do two things. Firstly, I will outline the origins of informality and its functions in recent Greek history. I approach informality not as an anomaly peculiar to the Greek political formation, but as an extra-institutional mechanism of redistribution, which has served to sustain a high rate of growth with minimal costs for the state and for employers, and to incorporate the population in the mainstream of social life. In this light, I will examine the four main pillars of informal welfare in Greece: clientelism, the informal sector, familialism, and homeownership. Secondly, I will offer an interpretation of the institutional reforms that followed the sovereign debt crisis and the bailout programs starting in 2010 as a concerted attempt to dismantle this informal system of redistribution and to extend the reach of the state in previously informalized areas of social and economic life, without, however, reinforcing a formal system of guarantees, such as the welfare state. According to some accounts, the presence of a sizable middle class and the resulting fragmentation of the subservient classes prevented the transformation of the state and the parliamentary system into an effective site of class antagonism. Thus, rules and democratic procedures have not been as important as familial ties, personal acquaintances, and networks of patronage. The necessary consensus of the subservient classes was not created within the institutions of the state as a field of political and class struggle, but extra-institutionally, in the networks of patronage and personal relationships. This laid the ground for informal welfare arrangements. It is important to note that informality in this sense is not the same as spontaneity. It does not denote the absence of planning or regulation on behalf of the state. Rather, informality constitutes an alternative normativity that is also a product of state action or inaction. The state determines what is informal and what is not, which forms of informality will thrive and which will disappear. Informality may be seen as a deliberate strategy of development that is chosen by the dominant class when it allows some competitive advantage. Rather than denoting a failure of the state, informality has been a tool at the state disposal, contributing to many of its successes. Parting from Esping Andersen's typology of three welfare regime types, the idea of informal welfare builds on the debate about the existence of a fourth, separate Southern European welfare state model, shaped by four features: clientelism, a large informal sector, familialism, and homeownership. Clientelism is a particularistic and highly inequitable system of redistribution in which access to privileges relating to the civil administration is exchanged for political support. In Greece, it has acted as a central mechanism of legitimation of state power, allowing common citizens some degree of influence on political matters through their patrons. Moreover, a job in the public sector obtained through university education or clientelist relations became a central mechanism of social mobility. A large informal sector is generally characteristic of corporatist welfare models, in which the traditional privileges of specific core sectors are safeguarded at the expense of precarious and underpaid sectors in a dualistic labor market. Employers and workers are thus given incentives to establish informal labor relations and thus circumvent social security contributions and other costs. Furthermore, in Greece, given the prevalence of small family firms and self-employment, tax evasion can be seen as an informal avenue of redistribution for families, in the absence of other welfare provision schemes and adequate formal protection against unemployment. Familialism denotes the prevalence of primary solidarities in the provision of social protection. In Greece, the family, which is defined as the extended kinship group, composed of various generations and spread across many households, plays a central role in providing welfare to its members. To achieve this, the extended family acts as an agent of decommodification by pooling monetary resources, non-market goods and services, employment opportunities, favors, political patronage connections, and real estate assets, and redistributing them among its members according to custom or need. This model presupposes the existence of a typically male breadwinner employed in the formal sector, with women doing extensive unpaid care work. Finally, home ownership was promoted by the state through a specific mode of informal urbanism, which evolved from state-sanctioned system of illegal self-construction into the land for flats swap system, which defined the urban landscape in Greece. The state promoted home ownership as a way to integrate workers into the social mainstream by turning them into small property owners. Real estate property signified at the same time a ticket to the middle class, a factor of egalitarianism, and a means of value accumulation for the popular classes. The above four pillars of informal welfare operate alongside a rudimentary corporatist welfare state, whose main elements are the pension system and an incompletely implemented universalist healthcare system. It is important to note that not only are formal welfare mechanisms layered on top of informal and familialist ones, but they also largely take their continuous operation for granted. We may call this a hybrid welfare state. We can thus argue that informal welfare, administered through its four pillars, was not a side effect or a malfunction, but a constitutive element of Greek capitalism. Informal provision allowed it to keep wages low and thus maintain competitiveness, while the state could avoid the fiscal pressures of welfare provision while preserving social peace. This arrangement permitted the Greek economic miracle of the 1950s and 1960s, with rates of growth higher than most OECD countries. However, following the eruption of the sovereign debt crisis in 2010, through successive waves of austerity measures linked to three major bailout agreements, wages, benefits, and pensions were drastically cut, the labor market was further flexibilized, and a series of regressive taxes were imposed. A deep recession brought down the GDP by about 30% and pushed unemployment up. To reduce deficit, the state further retreated from welfare provision. So, increased social needs and limited resources caused the informal welfare system to collapse, as all of its pillars were undermined. Clientelist networks were dismantled, not only because fiscal consolidation meant that there were no resources to distribute, but also because of a profound political legitimation crisis that destabilized the two-party system. There was also a strong drive for formalization of labor and curbing of tax evasion, especially for the self-employed, in order to enlarge the tax base and increase state revenue. The capacity of the family to accumulate and redistribute resources was drastically curtailed by reduced incomes, unemployment, odious taxation, and unsustainable levels of private debt. Finally, home ownership was challenged as non-performing mortgages multiplied and property taxes sextupled over the course of a few years, thus turning real estate from an asset into a liability. This shift caused the hybrid system to collapse, thus signaling a welfare crisis. The formal justification for Greece's radical restructuring program is to address four structural problems of the Greek economy: low competitiveness, high external debt, inflexible labor market, and a weak banking sector. By all accounts, the adjustment program has failed in all those aims. Specifically, not only the internal devaluation did not increase competitiveness, but falling domestic demand destroyed small businesses and thus exacerbated unemployment in a vicious circle that shrunk the tax base and thus state revenue, rendering fiscal consolidation all but impossible and leading to an increase in external debt. What we have seen in the case of Greece is a complete disconnection of the reproduction of capital from the reproduction of society, as no attention was paid in the economic adjustment program to the immense increase in poverty and the drastic drop in the population's standard of living. Along with the dismantling of informal welfare, the existing welfare state was residualized, thereby aiming not to ensure general welfare, but to prevent the most extreme and visible forms of poverty. The social collapse was accompanied by a delegitimation of the political system and brought about a period of prolonged instability. It is reasonable then to ask, why would the Greek political class and its European allies implement such a plan that would not only have disastrous economic effects, but would also undermine their own legitimacy and hegemony? I will argue here that the disastrous social effects of austerity were not simply the result of miscalculations, but the direct outcome of the logic of neoliberal restructuring. Loïc Vacan proposes that neoliberalism entails not the dismantling, but the re-engineering of the state. Its penal and repressive functions are reinforced, while its redistributive functions are curtailed, resulting in what he calls a center state, which reserves liberalism for those at the top, while it enforces punitive paternalism upon those at the bottom. This is in line with Werner Bonnefeld's conception of political authority as central in the ordo-liberal thought guiding the project of European integration. The ordo-liberal state is not the non-interventionist state, but the state that actively suppresses the politicization of the lower classes and imposes order on the system. In this light, we can approach the dismantling of informality in Greece. The concern of the institutions was not that the state was too strong, but rather that the state was too weak, too vulnerable to the influence of special interests, and thus not wholeheartedly dedicated to facilitating the penetration of capital. To exemplify this, we can examine how the fight against corruption in Greece was framed in terms of transparency. That is, it was not an attempt to disentangle private interests from public matters, but to make their entanglement more predictable, more calculable. That is, informal clientelist networks articulating small and medium-sized players would have to be replaced by a formal lobbying system that favors international capital. Informality then is conceived as an encroachment of society on the state and by extension on the market, which is a state institution. The decommodification and informal redistribution afforded by informal welfare are seen as obstacles in the effort to discipline workers and imprint a mentality of competitiveness and self-sufficiency on them. Moreover, a system relying on extra institutional arrangements and particularistic rules is obscure and incomprehensible for foreign capital and thus unconducive to investment. It is important to note that I don't intend here to take a normative stance regarding the operation of the Greek welfare system and the necessity of its reform. Concluding that the structural adjustment has produced social collapse does not constitute a defense of the pre-crisis welfare system in Greece. This was a system lacking in universalism and serving to perpetuate traditional inequalities, including patriarchal power and labor abuses. At the same time, however, it constituted the Greek economy's own path to modernity, and it permitted the social inclusion of large parts of the population in a context of minimal state welfare. My argument, rather, is that the conceptualization of informal practices as hurdles to capitalist expansion, or even as signs of underdevelopment, rather than as elements of welfare, has permitted the outright dismantling of informal welfare, without, however, its substitution with a formal system of guarantees. It has thus exacerbated inequality and created a sizable surplus population with dismal life prospects. Overall, austerity policies in Greece have not only proven destructive in economic terms, but have also severely affected the capacity for social reproduction.